Hello and welcome to my channel, Medicine with Dr. Moran. There are over 300 colleges and universities in America requiring students to get boosted in order to attend their classes this year. This is occurring in Canada as well. Now, these mandates have received a lot of criticism from students and evidence-based physicians. Is this an unnecessary barrier to education? Well, in this video, I'll review the actual risks for not receiving a third shot by comparing them to a study done using healthcare workers. Western University in London, Ontario, Canada, where I did my subspecialty medical training, has been getting a lot of media attention recently. The university mandates that students be up to date on their COVID-19 vaccines, including having a booster. This means they need to get three shots. And as I mentioned, many US colleges require this as well, but other Ontario universities in Canada, including the Western affiliate Brescia University, are not requiring booster doses for the school year. I note that there are also two large hospitals in the same city of London, which have not mandated booster dose requirements for their hospital staff, which obviously include nursing as well as medical staff. Many of the staff at the hospitals are obviously older than university students and would therefore actually be at a higher risk from SARS-CoV-2 infection than the university student. I think it's always important to realize that when different places do different things, the evidence is not clear-cut. Now, there have been protests as well as legal action by students at Western as the university announced their policy after students and parents paid tuition. Now, we know that the risk of serious disease to healthy young people was low even at the beginning of the pandemic when people had no immunity at all. Now, the risk has been modified significantly. It's much, much lower as many of the students have already had either infection with the virus, not to mention, of course, vaccination. Now, this study from the Lancet, which I want to talk about today, looked at healthcare workers in the province of Quebec, which was also in Canada. There's a link to the study in the description below. It's an observational study of healthcare workers 18 years of age or older, and it occurred between March 27 and June 4, 2022, when the Omicron BA2 was the predominant variant. They looked at the Quebec Immunization Registry to determine vaccination status, and they looked at the likelihood of BA2 infection or reinfection amongst these workers who had previously had primary infection and had received 0, 1, 2, or even 3 mRNA vaccine doses. And what they did was compare them to unvaccinated healthcare workers with no previous infection. This is their main summary slide, and it looks against protection against symptomatic BA2 illness. On the y-axis, if you look, going up is the adjusted risk reduction compared to unvaccinated participants without previous COVID-19 infection. There are three main groups on the x-axis: those that had no previous infection, those that had previous pre-Omicron infection, in other words, people previously infected with strains prior to Omicron, and then the third group was people who had previous Omicron infection with BA1. If you look at these three groups, you can see that the risk reduction against symptomatic infection was very high in the people that previously had Omicron infection and slightly lower in the group that had previous infection prior to Omicron and lowest in the group that never had ever had an infection. Now, many people, of course, have had infection now that we're really well into this pandemic and essentially, we're in the endemic phase. This virus is not going away at this point. Antibody studies in young people suggest previous infection rates now somewhere on the order of 60 to 80%. I want to bring to your attention the difference between two vaccines versus three. Now, I've circled in green these people who have had three vaccinations and those people who have had two vaccinations in red. As you can see, the difference is not statistically significant in this study. Remember that the graphs are for symptomatic infection. There were very few people in the study who ended up in the hospital, and there was only one death. This population of healthcare workers obviously is older than university students, as I mentioned. Obviously, a three-dose mandate at a university would allow the students in green to come to school, but not the students in red. So a student with two vaccinations and previous Omicron infection who would have an absolute risk reduction of 98% would not be able to go to university, but a student who had no previous infection and three vaccinations who only has a 70% reduction would be able to attend university. This is the nuance of evidence-based medicine. You have to remember that a simple one-size-fits-all policy when it comes to medical decision-making is never appropriate. We have many guidelines in medicine, but these are simply guidelines. They're not absolute. And this is why, as physicians, we discuss the evidence that we have with patients in order for the patient to make an informed decision. Their health depends upon that. And the simple one-size-fits-all policy has been very frustrating to physicians throughout the pandemic because that's not how we practice medicine. I encourage people who are not sure about their vaccination to discuss it with their physician. Many people at this point have had COVID, plus or minus a variable number of vaccinations, not to mention the timing of infection and vaccination. So different people have completely different risks going forward. The one thing I've been surprised by in the pandemic is the fact that many organizations have recommended vaccination very soon after infection, which makes no medical sense at all. I've talked about this in previous videos. When you have exposure to any foreign antigen, such as this virus or another virus, or to the spike protein through vaccination, your immune system responds over the span of weeks to months. And the immune system actually matures and it produces more than one kind of antibody. And this is why we see in clinical studies that vaccination generates antibodies that are active against Omicron strains, even though your body's never seen the Omicron spike protein. So getting a vaccine soon after a recent infection does not make sense. You want your body to mature your immune response from your infection first. Recent research, in fact, demonstrates that vaccination does impair, and I repeat, does impair, antibody and B cell responses to booster vaccination through 60 days. So that's 2 months. Now here's the preprint. It was from the end of August 2022, and of interest, even Dr. Fauci contributed to this research. Now there's a link below to this medical archive preprint. On my channel, I have reported the immunological studies on the immune response from different laboratories. Now, to be honest, this is something that I learned back in medical school in the late 1980s. This is why I thought it was very unusual that certain countries, including the US, chose to give vaccinations 3 or 4 weeks apart. The idea, of course, was to generate clinical research very quickly so that the vaccines were given close together. But once the research was published in the New England Journal, we realized that after that first shot, there actually was significant protection from symptomatic disease. It was not as high as the 95% with two shots, but it was over 80%. And of course, this is why many countries chose to give the second vaccination 2 months after the first, so that they could get as many of their highest risk citizens done with at least one shot before going around to do the second one. Now, I've spoken numerous times on my channel about when to get the second shot. I've presented a number of studies from Canada, both from Quebec and British Columbia, which demonstrated that there was benefit to wait at least 2 months. This actually makes clinical sense and goes back to what I learned in basic immunology class back in the late 80s. It's why I spaced my two injections actually 4 months apart. You simply get a better immune response. Comorbidities play into the risks, and the one thing that's been forgotten is telling people to get healthy to reduce not only the risk of severe disease from the virus, but also your risk from other health problems. There were daily COVID briefings, but I never saw one where people were really encouraged to do things to improve their health. It's sad to have seen so many people's health get worse during this pandemic. That's something I've talked about quite a bit on the channel. This should have been one of the primary focuses and one thing that I told many of my patients about when the pandemic started. I've made a couple of videos on how to optimize your immune system and improve your health. The links are in the description below. The important focus, of course, was to protect the elderly and the people with serious comorbidities who remain at risk of serious disease and death from the virus. forcing very low-risk, healthy university students to get a third vaccination in order for them to get their education, as you can see from the evidence that we have in 2022, does not make evidence-based clinical sense. The issue that students run into is, well, what about the future? How many boosters will students need to attend the university down the road? We know that antibody responses to vaccination unfortunately don't last very long. That's not exactly surprising. This is on the order of 3 or 4 months, and of course, repeated boosters with that kind of frequency are completely impractical. And then there's the risk of repeated vaccination. Now, I've not spoken about the risks of vaccinating young university students in this video, but that always has to be considered. You have to consider the risks and the benefits. One risk of repeated vaccination, but of course there are others, is that of myocarditis. We know the risk of myocarditis in young males, especially after the second Moderna vaccination, is on the order of 1 in 3,000 to 1 in 5,000, depending on what study you look at, and I've reported on this. It's far higher in this population than the risk of myocarditis from infection itself. I've reported also on how that risk can be reduced and what some countries have done to do that. Now, a recent prospective study from Thailand looked at 300 young people and they found the risks of both clinical and subclinical myocarditis to be much higher. It was actually 3.5%. We need more research to be done on this particular topic. Now, many physicians besides myself have pointed out what I've just told you using evidence like I've shown, as well as other evidence, that at this time, booster vaccinations for healthy university students don't make evidence-based clinical sense. Please remember, this is not anti-vax sentiment. Not anti-vax sentiment for me or other physicians, because we all know that vaccinations in people with high risk of severe disease have saved many lives during this pandemic. We also have Paxlovid, which is an antiviral, which is very effective in the same high-risk people to prevent severe disease. Of course, it must be given early in the illness, as I pointed out on my previous video with that. So if you're at high risk and you develop symptomatic COVID or a family member, then talk to your doctor or in some areas of the world, your pharmacist who can prescribe it straight away to be considered for this medication. Thanks a lot for joining me today on Medicine with Dr. Moran. My name is Dr. Keith Moran, and remember, get healthy and stay healthy.